The Dharma, incomparably profound and exquisite, is rarely met with even in hundreds of thousands of millions of kalpas. We now can see it, hear it, accept and hold it. May we realize the true mind of the Tathagata. Today is already day 6 of this 7-day sesshin here in August 2017 at Mountain Gate in northern New Mexico. And we are so incredibly fortunate to be here. Even more so has been brought home to me today when I got a text from one of my California students who's battled all her life from 2 autoimmune diseases that are genetically based. Her whole family has some level of them, but she has sort of hit the jackpot on it. And she was finally able to get some chemo that took out the particular cells that were causing one of those autoimmune conditions, and she was feeling so much better, so much better. It looked like she might even have the gastric tube, the GI tube removed. She's not 30 years old, and she's already had to live with a GI tube, in other words, to feed herself through a tube into her intestinal tract for several years already. That's a heck of a burden for someone that young. And so when she was able to get the chemo, it was miraculous because it worked. For 10 weeks it worked. 10 weeks in one day. And then she wrote me, it all came roaring back overnight. And she was in a coma in a ventilator until this morning when she was able to text me. It's not clear what will happen next. The chemo did work, and it's not clear whether it can be repeated or how often it can be repeated or what the final ramifications of it are, even if it is repeated. And then there is that second autoimmune condition that she's struggling with. She's been in the ICU, in the intensive care unit, in hospitals all over Southern California in an effort to save her life. She has to carry 6 EpiPens with her. It's actually because of the scandal involving the incredible increase in price of EpiPens once the manufacturer was purchased by another pharmaceutical company. The obscene increase in price, something like 600%, that it's actually cheaper for her to go to the ER than to use her EpiPens, because she always has to use more than one to save herself from going into anaphylactic shock. She starts to go into shock and then she can bring herself out if she stabs herself with those EpiPens. But as she said, it's cheaper rather than using more EpiPens to use the first one to get her safely to where she can be in an ambulance, and then to get to the ER is less expensive. There's something wrong with the healthcare system that it should be like that. Not the healthcare system, but with the pharmaceutical system, unfortunately. And they've been called on the carpet, but that hasn't changed anything other than the fact that the same manufacturer is now marketing a so-called generic version of EpiPens for half the price, only $300 and some. And it costs something like $35 to make the whole packet. It is really unethical. But at any rate, her name is Shannon, and I'd like to dedicate the energy, all of our energy, from this sesshin to her healing. It's a huge, huge burden she's had to deal with a good part of her life. She had wanted to become a chef, a pastry chef, and she had made, actually before she got really sick, she had made a couple of beautiful
beautifully decorated Buddha's birthday cakes for the Hidden Valley Zen Center years ago. But it turns out she's allergic to revolving door of items, and she never knows what is going to trigger really a potentially death creating effect. She goes into anaphylactic shock, which is major shock, which can kill a person on an incredibly regular basis, multiple times a week. And as I said, there's various different things. One day she could eat or touch one thing and it wouldn't be a problem. A few days later, the same thing could send her to the ER. So we are ourselves so fortunate, no matter what is going on in our lives, that you can hear this Teisho is incredible. That you can be here at Mountain Gate, those of you who are here at Mountain Gate in this Sesshin, or at any Sesshin. It is such an amazing miracle, really. It's really a miracle that we are alive at all, and more so that we are able to remain so to hopefully a long and fruitful life. So I'd like to continue today with the story and teachings of Nakagawa Soen Roshi from the book Endless Vow, which really is what he had. The subtitle is The Zen Path of Soen Nakagawa, and it was translated and put together by a team of three, Edo Shimano, who is one of his Dharma successors, and Shinge Roshi, who is the current abbot of Daibosatsu Monastery in New York State, and Kazuaki Tanahashi, who is a well-known translator and calligrapher in the United States. And we've already gone through a great deal of the book, as you can see, and we are now in part three, Teaching in the West, from 1959 to 1972. And this entry is dated July 16th, 1959. At midday, I land in Anchorage, Alaska. Having left in the evening, I arrive at noon of the same day. If you take a jet, it is possible for you to arrive before you've left. Past and future are all cut off. And really, what are past and future? But memories and assumptions and dreams, flowers in the air. What have we really other than this very present moment? Just this moment. And when we are willing to live in just this moment, our lives are rich and fulfilling, no matter what this moment contains. We so often, most people in the world, particularly in the West, live in the past or the future. And the moments go by, the present moments go by almost unnoticed. And then we wonder why our life is empty, flat, uninviting. And then unfortunately, some people take it to extreme and very negative levels in order to get some excitement into their lives. And we won't go into those things. So, past and future are all cut off. Today is the 8th of the month and tomorrow is the 13th. Today is the 8th of the month and tomorrow is the 13th. We once had a very interesting experience here in this Zendo during a Rohatsu Sesshin, where the clock literally jumped 13 minutes ahead while we were doing Kinin. Hasn't done that since, and it didn't do that before. Was somebody wishing Kinin would be over? Fish swim in the trees and birds fly in the ocean. Such statements by old Zen teachers cannot be appreciated enough. And in order to appreciate them, or our life in general, deeply enough, we need to step out of our usual framework of reference, our usual assumptions about life, about others, about ourselves. And allow ourselves to sink into the present moment. If we stand aside from our ideas about it, it's quite amazing what we can experience and what avenues lie open to us that we wouldn't have noticed otherwise. So he writes a haiku. Flying through the clouds, white night, that's N-I-G-H-T, Alaska. And then in February of 1960, after flying for 9 hours, I arrive in Honolulu. The first sesshin in Hawaii is held from February 3rd to 8th. It's just a 5-day sesshin. People from different countries and of various races enter samadhi in one hall with one mind. Right after we rise, during kinhin beneath the star-filled sky, the breeze swirls through the palm leaves, cooling our feet. Behind the dojo, among the steep, ragged-edged walks, tall cactus plants stand in groups like humans. Cardinals sing their high-pitched tunes in harmony with white eyes, a species of bird that was imported from Japan and seems to flourish in Hawaii. These birds manifest a paradise. Water, birds, trees chant Buddha's name, chant Buddha's teachings. When I asked the name of the mountain that spits out the great disk of the sun each morning, I was told Mount Koko. In the native language, Koko means blood red as seen in a rainbow. Splendid! Each shower brings a 7-hued masterpiece that seems raised by the mountain's gentle curve. So I've named this new Zendo Koko-an. Koko-an. Koko means here in Japanese. Right here. In resonance with, quote, this very place is the lotus land from Hakuin's Song of Zazen. This very place, Koko. And then he writes another haiku. Each tropical blossom, everlasting world of everlasting summer. And then in spring 1961, at the age of 96, Genpo Roshi is still vital. He has probably signed his name, Hanya, which means prajna in Japanese, which also means wisdom, more than 84,000 times. The poetic theme given by the emperor to this year happens to be youthfulness. I'm celebrating the true body that is before birth and beyond old age by whisking tea in a bowl on whose inner surface Genpo Roshi wrote youthfulness and on whose exterior he wrote old age. And then he writes, young ox plodding home, original spring. In autumn of the same year, the preparation of a monastery for winter may seem unremarkable. Everything that needs to be attended to is done, and yet no trace of effort is apparent. This expresses the spirit of my teacher, Genpo Yamamoto Roshi, who spent most of his time doing zazen, and who was often completely absorbed in studying the Diamond Sutra. The Diamond Sutra is a very short sutra, said to have been uttered by the Buddha himself, and it is quite an amazing sutra. The sixth patriarch, who was an itinerant young man, I think he was 19 years old at the time, had grown up, his father died when he was 3, and his mother was penniless after that. It was way before there was anything like Social Security, and they lived in a very remote area of China, where his father, who had been a statesman in the government service, in China had somehow angered the people at the top and was banned and shipped off to this remote area as punishment, and also to get him away from where he might cause problems with his attitudes. And he married a local woman and they had a child, a little boy. And before he was of an age, which would have been about 4, where his father would have been able to teach him how to read and write, they did that early in China in those days, he died. And so the child didn't ever learn to read and write because his mother couldn't do that. And of course, they certainly couldn't afford to go to a school. And every day he went with his mother out into the woods to pick up sticks when he was little. And as he grew older, to break off branches and create firewood that they then hauled into the village to sell to bring in enough money to eat and survive. And when he was 19, he was delivering a load of firewood to a client and happened to hear an itinerant pilgrim chanting the Diamond Sutra. And when it came to the part in the Diamond Sutra that speaks this way, arouse the mind that abides nowhere. Arouse the mind that abides nowhere. He had a deep awakening experience. Arouse the mind that abides nowhere. You know, in the West, we just assume our mind is up here, captured by our brain. And if anything happens to our brain, then it happens to our mind as well, which to a certain degree may be true. But the truth is, our mind is not limited by the architecture of the brain or the body. It's known that the heart can communicate with other beings, people, animals. They've so far tested it 8 feet away. Perhaps by now they've tested it farther away. That was the last I heard, and that was several years old. But hearts communicate, bodies communicate, mind communicates, unlimited by this physical body. So, what are the options then? This is worth exploring. Where is your mind? Can you find it? Can you finger it? Can you describe it? This is why one of the koans, one of the breakthrough koans in Rinzai Zen is, show me the face before your parents were born, your face. How can we do that? But we can. Continuing on. Gimpo Yamamoto Roshi spent most of his time doing Zazen and was often completely absorbed in studying the Diamond Sutra. He would say that you are not yet mature if you are seen as great or wise by others. And this is another excellent point. There's a story of a Zen student, deeply realized actually, and every time he went to sit Zazen, the birds would drop flowers around him. And then when he got deeply enough enlightened, they didn't do that anymore. Why not? One day, someone came to talk to Kapler Roshi at the Rochester Zen Center. It was summer. I think he was a reporter, actually. And he was sent out to the garden because Roshi was out in the garden. He came back in a few minutes later and said the Roshi's not in the garden. The only person out there is the gardener. Well, the gardener was Kapla Roshi. And similarly, at Sogenji, someone came to speak with Harada Shodo Roshi and was sent off to the Hondo and told that the Roshi was in the Hondo. And the person came back and said, the Roshi's not in the Hondo, it's just there's just some monks in the Hondo. Well, one of those monks was the Roshi. This is really a high praise when someone of deep spiritual realization doesn't stand out in the crowd as somebody special in the way most people look at somebody special. There is something about those people, some quality, but they certainly don't go around in fancy clothes and the noses in the air, or ride in fancy cars, or any of the rest of that. Neither Kapla Roshi nor Harada Roshi drove. I mean, Harada Roshi's still alive, and Kapla Roshi died some years back, but neither one of them drive for various different reasons. With Kapla Roshi, he would get lost, and it would be very difficult to find him if he was out driving around and couldn't find his way home. With Harada Roshi, the reasoning was different because his teacher, Yamaramumon Roshi, had been, he'd been driving and he was in an accident, and somehow it either involved a yakuza, which is the Japanese mafia, or someone related to them, and so from then on they extorted money from him to keep it quiet. Until one day, one of Mumon Roshi's monks said, let me handle it. And that was the end of it. So Harada Roshi does not drive, simply not to put himself in the same kind of circumstances. The cars that they drive in, or the ride in, at Sogenji, they're all used cars, nothing special. And they're sort of on loan from somebody who takes in older cars and repairs them and donates the use of one or two of them for a year or two at a time to Sogenji. At Rochester, the same thing. It was, well, not exactly the same thing, but it was used cars. It was rare for the center to buy a new car. Money just wasn't spent on those things. And so these wonderful teachers went around as if nothing was special about them, and they didn't feel that anything was special about them, and that is even more important. And yet, the reason why Harada Roshi became a Zen monk was because he encountered, by chance, Yamaramumon Roshi on a bus, on a crowded bus, one day early in, Kyoto, because he was going to school at the time. And he was so drawn to Mumon Roshi's demeanor, this profoundly, inwardly quiet, gentle older man dressed in priest robes, which really flummoxed Harada, because he had ideas about what the role of a priest was growing up himself in a Zen temple. His father was a priest of the family temple sort, which is different from a Roshi. And he never wanted to be a priest, never wanted to ordain. And luckily, he had an older brother who was able to be pulled out of his work as a salaryman and trained as a monk or as a priest so that he could take over the family temple when his father died. But that left his younger brother, Harada Shodo, to continue in his own trajectory, and he was going to become a psychologist. When he was a kid, he wanted to be a rocket scientist. But by the time he got to college, he wanted to be a psychologist because he had a lot of sense that he had some issues that he wanted to deal with. He didn't like himself. And this may be familiar to some of you listening to this Taisho. And so he wanted to study psychology to learn how to make himself better. And the encounter with Mumon Roshi was so strong, the connection, the sense of something special about this man, that he actually, they got off the bus at the same place. As it turns out, that's where young Harada was supposed to go, at least get off at that bus stop, because he was on an errand from his father. And he followed Mumon Roshi and saw where he went, which was into the temple Ryunin in one of the sub-temples. It was one of the sub-temples of Myoshinji. And that turned his life around. He became a Zen monk. As soon as he finished college, he walked on foot to the temple in Kobe, Japan, where Mumon Roshi was then teaching, and became his student, and eventually became his Dharma successor. So, nothing special, but something special. Nothing special in the ordinary society-valued way of being special. And yet, when a person is deeply let go, those who are sensitive and aware experience that. One time, and this has nothing to do with being sensitive and aware necessarily, but one time I was in deep anguish in my very earliest years at the Rochester Zen Center. Something big had triggered some of my old conditioning, and I asked Kepler Rishi if I could come talk to him about it. I had at that point lost about 20 pounds because of the anguish I was in. And he said yes and set an appointment time and date, and I came and I went into his quarters. He was sitting on this funny little sofa that he had that he had specially made by Sangha people so that he could sit full lotus on the darn thing. So it was a little deeper seat and a little flatter seat than most. And he beckoned to me to sit down on the sofa, so I did. And all of a sudden, I knew that everything was going to be okay, to the point where there was no point in even talking about it, whether it turned out this way or that way. It was not going to be a problem. Somehow, I tuned into Kepler Rishi's mind state. And indeed, it wasn't a problem. When we allow ourselves to open to, we don't even know what, allow ourselves to get out of our ideas, our heads, our thinking, our assumptions, it's amazing what we can come to understand. And in our Zazen, this is exactly the direction we want to take. We have here this incredible extended out breath called Sesokan as our fundamental practice, coupled with the innate, it's hard to put it into words, but curiosity is about the best you can do. Curiosity, yearning, there's something that has brought us to want to practice Zazen. And here at Mountain Gate, we're relatively remote, and so we don't really get people who are interested in practicing Zazen here because they think it's really cool to be a Zen practitioner. We get people who come because they need to come. They need to practice. Their yearning is pulling them deeply within. And the Susokan helps with that. It helps cut through the extraneous thinking, the assumptions, the ideas. And as we do that out-breath, it requires increasing focus. That is its gift, because you don't just breathe out and breathe in again. You breathe out as long and focused on the experience of breathing out as you can. And you push it a little further at the bottom instead of immediately breathing back in. In-breath is done naturally without any control whatsoever. But allowing the out-breath to fall out and then to extend it brings about this natural focusing of awareness, and at the same time, an expansion of awareness. It seems contradictory, but it does happen. And in that focus, where you're totally focused on the experience of breathing out, drawn deep within yourself by the yearning, and we do it over and over and over and over and over and over and over again, moment by moment, going deeper. Sometimes coming up for air, as soon as we realize that, we want to recommit to the extended out breath so that we continue to go deeper. Now, if something comes up in the way of an intense memory, and anyone who's been traumatized is likely to have that happen sooner or later. If that does happen, then to allow yourself to temporarily abandon the extended out-breath, but stay present still with the experience of the energy in your body to the degree that you can. Allow yourself to explore those bodily sensations that this memory brings up. And in that way, it's quite possible that you'll be allowing it to process through. We all have a history of conditioning. Some of us have stronger, more intense, more traumatic conditioning than others. And this is how to work with it. Of course, if it gets really intense, you do want to work with a skilled trauma therapist who understands Zen practice. Because if you get into the wrong therapy office, they are very likely to can the practice, or to feel like it's the devil's work or something like that. There have been cases like this in the past. So you want somebody who does Vipassana or mindfulness exercises, or even better, Rinzai Zen practice. So they understand what you're doing in the Zendo, and they're not going to automatically condemn it. So back to Soen Nakagawa Roshi. Let's go through this whole autumn 1961 entry again. The preparation of a monastery for winter may seem unremarkable. Everything that needs to be attended to is done, yet no trace of effort is apparent. That's how we do our practice, yes? This expresses the spirit of my teacher, Genpo Yamamoto Roshi, who spent most of his time doing Zazen, and who was often completely absorbed in studying the Diamond Sutra. And we would recommend here that if you want to get into the sutras, you start with the Diamond Sutra, and you stick with it, and you read a passage, and you go and sit Zazen, and let it go, let it sink into your psyche without thought, and go right into that extended out breath and that yearning, searching for the true reality He would say that you are not yet mature if you're seen as great or wise by others. It's not good to be absent-minded, but you should be unpretentious while being aware of all necessary matters. This is important. In the old days, when Zen was first popular in the United States, in the 1950s with the Beat Generation, there was an assumption that Zen meant do whatever you feel like, it just doesn't matter. But that's not Zen, that's license. And it can be the source of suffering. Real Zen practice allows us to discern wordlessly, to understand intimately where to put our foot next, what to do next, and how to do it. So his poem in that case is Zen Monastery Unpretentiously Prepared for Winter. And here is his calligraphy for Prajna, or Hanya, which is transcendental wisdom. And then in January 1962, he writes, "This is the year of the tiger, a creature of great daring. It is said the tigers make journeys of 1,000 miles, returning in one day." Well, could be, perhaps. "We live in a time of emergency. Even the Earth's atmosphere is polluted. Yet there is a realm that is originally pure. Not even a speck of dust can alight there. Returning to the original source, let us be as swift as tigers on this path." And one might say as brave and persistent. And that realm that he is speaking of is not someplace else. It's right here now. And we can awaken to it if we allow ourselves to drop beneath all our assumptions and our conditioning around who we think we are, what we think life is, and be careful not to assume anything about what this quote other realm close quote might be like either, because that realm is beyond words, beyond description, and yet very, very real. And through your practice, you can reach it. We're already in day 6 of the Sesshin. We're already almost done with day 6 of the Sesshin. I urge you to keep going deeper and deeper and deeper, so that you can realize within your own being that true body of Buddha. I thank you for listening, and we'll stop now and recite the four vows.